meeting.
Mine's all phoned in.
And I guess everyone's here that needs to be here, and that's a good thing. Approve the agenda, please. Counselor Smith moving, a seconder, please.
Second.
Counselor Dunn, seconding. Moving second, all in favor? Adoption of the minutes of the committee of the whole meeting held June 26th. Counselor Erickson moving, seconder, Counselor Stewart. Questions or comments pertaining to the minutes? All those in favor? Contrary, motion carries. Fortunate to have with us tonight, Open Area Transition Society representatives, affectionately known as HATS. And we have with us Mr. Paul Keller, Ms. Roxanne Turcott, and Allison Patterson. So she's not missing in action tonight?
She is missing in action.
Okay, that's good. Hopefully safe and okay, everything's all good there. So, but we have two of the three, so that's good. And the floor is yours. We have till 7, so we can invest the necessary time. And I understand you put on a briefing for our internal and external staff, which was very well received, to spread awareness about homelessness and addiction issues within our district. So I heard some very positive comments about that presentation. I guess, is this a similar presentation?
Oh, it's very short. We had lots of hours. We had 2 hours in the morning, 2 hours in the afternoon, the others.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But this is sort of the Cole's Notes version of what they saw. Okay, perfect.
So I'm going to speak first. Where do you want me to stand? Over there, over here?
That's perfect there. As long as you won't block the camera, because the good folks in the right chairs, they want to tape this, so.
Okay, so hello, everybody.
Sorry, I just want to make note that I have no conflict of interest in being in the committee of the whole meeting. So I just want that to be on record, so that there's no controversy later on.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Hello, everybody. My name's Roxanne. I'm the Adult Addiction Counselor at Open Area Transition Society. And I'm going to just open with a little bit about addiction and what I do and our program around addiction. And then Paul is going to take over talking about what he does a little bit, the T-Bird, the Thunderbird. So I work with adults that are 25 years and older. So I work with anyone in active addiction, who have been in active addiction or are around addiction. So that covers a lot of people. Usually I have at least 35 open files all the time. That's closing people every month and then opening new people or reopening people. So it's very busy. We also have a youth addiction counselor, so she works with clients up to the age of 25. We also have an outreach worker, and that's Allison, and she is doing so many things with other people. So she works with mental health and addiction clients in a community support role, and that covers a lot of things. So I also work with probation, I work with the courts, I work with lawyers, I work with the police, we work with a lot of community members and service providers. I work closely with Paul as well. So I help people to get to a place of where they want to be. So it's not up to me what I think their life should be. It's up to them what they think their life should be. So that's a key point. We can't tell people what to do. We can just help them get there. So we try to work on a strength-based perspective. So we start there, because a lot of people, which Paul will talk about, are broken. And that's the word that we use. And we can't fix people. We can only help show them a different way. we are going to take questions after, correct?
Yeah, absolutely. So you have this handout, I believe, that was sent. So we're just going to fly through this, but there's some key things we wanted to share with you that we think is important. There's been a lot of talk in the community about some of the challenges that we're experiencing in the park, so we want to address those. If you have questions, we want to know. This is the best time to ask the most difficult, even if it's uncomfortable question. I can give you only what I have and absolutely what we have. We've been doing this work for a long time, so it's not our first rodeo with these folks, and we'll continue to work with them, so, yeah. Anything else you want to add?
No, I think that's it.
So ask your questions as I go through. So yeah, my name's Paul Keller, so I'm the program coordinator out at the Thunderbird, working for HATS. And this presentation here, I hope we can work this up, there we go. I want to give you the scope of what we really do, because I think people think, gee, what goes on up there? And unless you've really visited and spent about 45 minutes with me to an hour at minimum, you'd really not get a grasp of the work we do. And that's being missed. And it gets missed because we do, and it's rightfully so. It's kind of like police work. They go out and they do 90% prevention crime, and the 10% they don't prevent, my gosh, people are wondering, what the heck is going on over there? And it can take one client, or three, or five, or to create a lot of damage in our community, especially if they're experiencing homelessness, addiction, mental health, other challenges going on. So this is our premise. We have 3 acres. I'm going to try and do this in 15 or 10, and then if you have questions. We have 24 units, 4 shelter beds, a drop-in center, and a shelter. And we also do extreme weather program in the winter. We have a partnership with the owner. The property is not leased, it is given to us for free. The only thing we pay for is the shelter upstairs, which is about 1,000 square feet. The drop-in is free, the grounds are free. The units we use, he pays for his stuff. He pays for the rentals and the lights and the heat and whatever has to happen out there, his taxes. And we do the work. And that's always been the arrangement with the owner out there. And I've always appreciated him, I must say, in 8 years. Great guy, not one obstacle. And partnerships matter in this line of work, whether it's a partnership with the district or a partnership with an owner that's got property or mental health or police. It doesn't matter. Homelessness is not a single agency, it's not district's problem, it's not HATS' problem. You'll never address these complex individuals and sometimes families without a collective. So these are the people we target. I'm going to fly through this and stop me at any time. You know, for the most part out at the Thunderbird, we're dealing with some really challenging people that are absolutely, absolutely homeless. Like, it's just a daily thing. There's a lot of people in society, and our town's no different. You'll recognize some of these folks. So, you know, one of the things that distinguish us or differentiates us from other programs is that we're not institutional. We absolutely look at the heart and soul and the meaning behind a person, and we try to get in line with that individual to help him make better choices or to allow that person to say yes to what we're offering. Because, you know, if I was getting bank services or I myself wanted addiction services, I absolutely could keep the appointment and I absolutely would just show up and get it done because I need it. But our clientele, it's not like that. You know, I really appreciate Wilfred, the one time where we got together, and you can see how difficult it is. We offer, 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 and what are you going to do other than keep offering and keep open and be inclusive and respectful? Because at the end of the day, it is the adult, not the child. We're not dealing with children. It is the adult that's going to decide if they want the help or not. And most people, they want it, but they're stuck, right? They're really stuck. So we're looking at these meaningful things. And I think most of you may have read this, if not, you can at another time. And that stuff matters, by the way. Like, when you're helping broken people, that stuff matters. Creating a community, creating a space, and a place that feels safe, inclusive. Here's some of the stuff I want to talk about. So if you look at what we do and what we do have, like, really, the Thunderbird is trying to address an attack, a multitude, and you need to do this with people. Like, you just don't build a building and say, gee, we're going to address chronic homelessness or those challenging folks out there. You're not. And that's, I think, one of the reasons a lot of the city's numbers are going up. They're building buildings, and they expect the people to be independent and live on their own. And that doesn't necessarily happen with those that are really challenged. You need semi-independent living with a variety of things going on. We meet for a resident meeting once a month and support meetings once a week. and those are meaningful. If you have, and you're welcome to attend these things, especially a support meeting. I want to highlight these services as well. Just so you know what we're doing, because we're doing a lot. Like over the 8 years, this program didn't start like this, trust me. Started with me, the owner of the agency, and then we started pulling in with the residents, because some still live with us and will always need us. It's just not a matter of fixing your farm. They're not you and I, not joking. Could be, I don't know. Could be better than you and I one day. But let's not assume that when you see someone, gee, they went to school, I went to school with that person. Or, you know, I hold a job, I had it tough. We're all different, and I think when we met with the staff here, and I really appreciated that you folks, the district allowed us to come in for 4 hours, 2 hours in the morning, 2 hours in the afternoon, because I think we broke down a lot of barriers, and I think we had a chance to reflect back and forth. But these services are vital, and these services are the professional ones that go along with the meaningful ones, which are in the prior slides. And you could never just professionally, you know, show up and do a bank service, I don't know, do a detox service. And it's really strict, like it's, yeah, no. Housing and semi-independent living and the way we're going to address this has to be inclusive and encompass a variety of things. Sorry, there was one more. Off-site, this project does. Any questions so far as we're going through? I think it's, again, important you understand what does happen. If you were to come for a visit, you would see the odd folks that used to be a burden on the streets that aren't anymore. And if I evict one tomorrow, I guarantee you things would go. We've watched this. We've tracked negative police contacts in the past where we've had someone come in the Thunderbird. We looked at all the negative police contacts prior to the Thunderbird for over a year and then while you've been with us. Now, granted, we still get contact. But it's like cut in half for sure. And that's an improvement, right? I'm not joking. You're not fixing, you're trying to adjust people into a better way. This is meaningful stuff. He came into the office, he gave me a bouquet of flowers, I got a pick of it. And like, I'm telling you, that's how you're gonna get people showing up and saying, you know what? I like my life, I like this. I wanna do better. You won't get it by fixing or institutionalizing. So our grounds and our gardening is key. That 3 acres, that space, right? Like we have things going on and we need to. I often compare it to if you're doing youth programs with youth or senior programs with seniors, they're a special population. And if you choose not to recognize that, you're gonna miss the boat. You need to look at this population as a whole, those experiencing homelessness, mental health and addiction and social inadequacies. They've experienced failure a lot. And then you have to create environments that are warm and inviting and promote wellness. This is how we measure success up there. It's not, you know. And I can see this, like I can see people. I can see people maintaining a unit and not. We can see negative traffic that comes and goes and not. We can see people walk in with self-care or not. You can see them pay their rent or not. These things matter. Maybe not to you and I, it's all common sense. But for the group I'm working with, this isn't common sense. You know? And so we have to recognize in society that we're going to get people and that are going to need this little extra support. So most programs stop at safety. You start at the bottom and you work your way up. As soon as someone's sick, bang, you're gone. No longer a client, we're good. And this is what is a problem. Programs, especially this population, now if you're dealing with teens, that would be another one. If you're dealing with seniors, that would be another one. So we get this stuff in our community because we have motivation and driving connections and education and money and homes and relatives and friends that go on and on and on and on. Like we have things that we have built over the years and we haven't broken yet. Maybe some of us have and we bounce back. But most programs will start at the bottom, work their way to safety as soon as you're well, they're done. Well, the Thunderbird goes all the way up the ladder and we're looking at all these areas. And this isn't rocket science. my kids need this, you need this, I need this, our clients need this in a program, in a premise. I'll call it a program a cube, but it's their residence, their home, it's my work, right? I won't get too much into these, but or I could, if there's questions around these models and approaches we use, I can understand where some people may wonder, why do you do that? And so this would be the time if you don't understand harm reduction or housing first.
I just want to add something to that, Paul. We always talk about this, and if someone's homeless, they're not going to be looking at their addiction issues, right? Addiction is what's keeping them alive out there sometimes. So until people find a safe place to live, they're not going to tackle their addiction issues. Very rarely would they even look at it. Why would you? Right? That's what keeps them alive out there.
So the clients that are out on the street now, they get access to all this that I've just told you. Not joking. And they do come to us. Just like the ones before them that live there now, it takes time. And we don't get everybody. You know, it's like you in the district. You're not going to do everything on your list that you need to do in this town. But you should get some progress. You should make some movement. Otherwise, a lot of us would say, gee, I'm not working there. I'm going to quit my job. It's useless. We do go places. We do get folks. We do see a transition from the street into dropping into shelter and into residency. What we don't see that you may wish we did see was them employed, putting, you know, and they're on and they're independent. A lot of the people I'm focused with working on have chronic challenges going on forever. We just renovated the premise, so this is as far as the drop-in. Now the owner paid for this. And, you know, back in the day, we really started that whole room with just storage. With the residents, again, we're instilling ownership, a place to contribute in your life. Why don't you help out? You live here. Like, we're teaching skills. I made exchanges with people that are residing and working with me at the learning group. You're not coming and just taking the rent with the language. What are we doing? Because I get paid by the hour. Like, what are we going to do? And then it's really hard. It's, even if they agree, it's not easy. It's not easy. You know, we've all had difficult people in our lives. Change is not easy. And this is kind of the ground stuff. So there's a few of our folks, our Raspberry Orchard. They did like 80 jars of jam out there this year. A success. And ask me if that fills the heart or makes you feel like you should respect the premise. If someone came in our orchard and destroyed it, I'll tell you. Mm-hmm. There's ownership, and we're trying to transfer that out to the community. If you respect your home, maybe you'll respect your neighbor. You respect your home and your neighbor, maybe you'll respect the streets of where you live in, and vice versa, the country that we live in, the privilege we live in here, right? But it's got to start somewhere, and we focus on here. Respect this space, this place.
Whoa.
I'll say one thing about all this. There's a massive gap with the ones that are the most, difficult in our community, in every community, and it's mental health and housing and supports. I'm not joking. It's sad to see. And I can't fix that. I could never provide something for that. It's just way beyond, right? And you know, cities have had them, and they haven't even tried. It's such a mess. You hear it on the radio all the time, which I like. This talk will hopefully create some change. These partnerships and these collectives are key. I could never stand without Roxanne, without the agency, without BC Housing, without Anne Young, like without at least half of those residents like engaged. Like you would fall. It's such a hard work to do, but it matters. So again, I so appreciate you folks connecting with us. It's been years. So I'd love to do this on an annual basis, for sure. I think education and conversation works, and it doesn't have to be one-sided. You can get your opportunity and ask any questions you like.
Yeah,
yeah. Holy smokes. It's hard to do that
in such under the wire, you breathe.
It's hard to do that in such little time. Any questions?
Well, I'm sure we'll have a couple here, but I'd like to start by thanking you, Mr. Miller, Council. Mr. Goffler,
yes.
coming here and doing your thing. And I know the community is appreciative of your work. I know it's tough work, and obviously work that doesn't always bear immediate fruit, but it's good to stick with it. And we're certainly behind you on that.
Well, questions and council presentation.
Councilor Crowe.
Thank you. So I'd just like to say thank you as well for all the work that you guys do. I know that, Paul, I know you fairly well. I'm sorry I don't know you as well, but I do appreciate everything that you guys are doing out there, because it doesn't just end there. Whatever you do there ends up being reciprocated down anywhere in the community or wherever the people go that have felt, you know, the kindness and the start of a new journey, I guess. I like to think of it as the start of a new journey. I'm just wondering how you've done it for so long. It's just such a big, big job.
I get to show up, and this is truth. I get to show up, and you wouldn't believe the men and women we work with. And when you see this change, and you see these increments of change, when you see someone, you know, we take our Will, for example, very hard, very don't want to talk, very won't go any place as far as conversation that's meaningful with you. Self-care through it gets terrible. Like, there's a lot of anger and frustration, and months later, or sometimes years later in some cases, and this is why it matters to keep going. Because in 8 years, and you know, I've seen ladies come through now in the last three that I'm looking back to the first time I met them, and I thought, boy, she used to rip me apart, and now she sits and we can. And they're coming to us, reaching out. So we see successes where you folks won't, and we see a lot. But we get a lot of baggage and garbage and stuff with this job as well, and they balance out, and they should. Okay, seeing all these kind of works, they come with a certain, yeah. And so I'm just happy when I show up at work if I can ignore the baggage. I don't even go on Facebook anymore or read the paper anymore because I don't want to go there. Just want to go to work, do my job, and stay focused, because it'll tip me, right? So the strategies you use, I need it.
Same. I did make a mistake and go on Facebook, and yeah, that's not good to do that. Everyone stay off Facebook. A lot of it's not true, like what's being said out there about what goes on, like it's not true. It's like the Inquirer, it's not true, it's fake news. So, you know, keep that in mind when you're reading some of the accusations that are going on about, you know, what goes on out there.
Or come and ask. It's just a beautiful thing if it affects you and it's part of your world. Like, you can phone me. You can just pick up the phone and say, hey, Paul, I've heard this. As crazy as it is, you should do it, because we're dealing with social issues that are quite raw. And I get calls all the time in that regard.
Thank you, Paul and Roxanne, for coming. If I were to ask you, what would be your number one major need today out there? Just one major need. What would it be?
Staffing. So we're good in the day. We had a conversation with BC Housing. We're looking at getting to about 3/4 staffing out there. But you cannot take 30 plus people of very challenging, complex backgrounds and have nobody on site at night or on the weekends. And you can't run a shelter like that. Or even me, we have term positions. So I'm the only one that has pretty much an ongoing position with BC Housing. So it's not one, well, it is one thing. It's staffing, 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 but they need to be permanent positions. You can't even begin to address this complex population without adequate supervision and support. Like, that's a no-brainer. And what we've been doing. Inadequately. And we're still finding success in some, but it's a real tough job.
Now this may be an ignorant question, but I'm going to ask you, what about volunteers?
Absolutely.
Do they have to be trained?
Well, what we do, we have volunteers at the Thunderbird, and very appreciate that, because what happens is they get this interaction with us, with them, with people that are just donating and dropping stuff off. There's a little interaction there that is very meaningful, and it aligns them with the community. So we have 6 out there that are doing well, and they give some time and labor or whatever they want to do. We have one gentleman that just sits and talks with people for 2 hours. So yeah, we use volunteers, we'd love more, but we need a little orientation. We need to talk about boundaries with our clients. We need to talk about safety. We need to talk about just different things, see if there's a fit there.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I was just going to add that we do have some, shelf, yeah, and my card. So I'm just going to leave them here, and if anyone's interested, they can grab them. And always open for calls if you have any questions about anything around addiction, active addiction, past addiction, someone you know, a neighbor. I worked with a neighbor the other day. I was telling your staff the other day, he popped in worried about a neighbor. And I'll work with anybody about anything to do with and around addiction. So anything you need to know, you can call. I'm going to leave that right here. Cards.
I just want to also say thank you. Before being on council, I really didn't have a lot to do with this world or understanding, and I'm quite grateful to have been invited to certain sessions. And the more I know, the more I know I don't know. And so I just want to say thank you. Thank you for continuing to educate people, even though you don't always meet positive results. That you keep going, and I like your perseverance, so please continue to educate.
Well, thanks. I appreciate that.
Thank you very much. And we're on time and under budget. Council member.
Thanks. I have maybe a quick question, but one question I've heard asked out there, and I have some clarity on, but this is an opportunity, like, to ask questions. So where does the Thunderbird project fit in low barrier type?
Wow. Okay, so the way I work, I don't care who you are, your strike from barriers. If you're willing to say yes to a conversation with me, we're going to go someplace if you're homeless, like we're going to work together. So there is no area to my hand. But we run into problems because, and I have to address everybody without discrimination or prejudice. I have to give them the benefit of the doubt. Because in my work, I have found the most toughest ones make the most progress. Not the ones that show up and can dress well and talk and they're homeless and everything's together, but they got a few things. So, yeah, we, I say we are absolutely low barrier, but we're classified as a moderate barrier premise or moderate barrier shelter, right? But we're, especially our locals, we have some real tough ones out there. If they called me tomorrow, there'd be opportunity. And again, we're engaging these folks, we're trying to. And so what we need to do is make sure we have a menu of services that someone would be attracted to and come and take, because you need help. And it's not just going to be detox and treatment
or a med, right?
It's got to go further than that. So yeah, I hope that answers your question.
Yeah, that kind of made me think about another question. So you only have 24 rooms, and I'm sure there's some level occupancy there, but how many people do you help outside that aren't housed there?
Yeah, we get drop-in all the time, and the drop-in creates an opportunity to see if we can work together. It creates a little period where you can access showers, laundry, support services. So if we were just dropping people into home right away, I think we'd be less effective. But we're always full, so they come, they access drop-in, we build rapport relationships, see where we could work together or not, because, again, I have to be careful out there because one tenant can create the whole, can shift the whole environment. Yeah. But again, they're trying to give people the benefit of the doubt if they can come in and meet with us. And so,
And you also work with people in the community as well, not
yeah,
just
like we'll probably get, 10 a day, right? Like it's drop ins. Like, and we allow a little bit of couch surfing too, not joking. They know each other. And we're watching, monitoring, we're working with the ones we do have that want to bring someone in and try and help them. So it's quite the rhythm, right? But you need to be open like this. You need to have a lot of tolerance and patience and inclusivity, right?
So those relationships you talked about too.
Yeah.
It is about building relationships.
They create a lot of help. They do 50% of work themselves. And we need that. Like, it's like us, it's not going to be a professional to come in and fix you, although there's supports there. I drop in plays a good key role.
And not everybody out there is in active addiction, contrary to what some people may believe. There's lots of people in recovery out there that haven't used anything in even over a year or two. Like, it's quite amazing, the mix out there.
We see people quitting smoking as their goal now. Like, it's just awesome. Oh, yeah. They're looking at health, they're looking at wellness, they're looking at going to the rec center more maybe. or, yeah, so it's really neat to watch and see when you see how, where they've come from. Quite traumatic, crazy experiences. Most of our folks have a history that we need to draw on, not joking. And so we have to understand that, but it doesn't mean we tolerate
bad behavior.
Safety issues or bad behavior. We're trying to model it. And we do it that way.
Well, did you see a lot come back to show how well they're doing, or?
So what happens is we get a lot of people, there's a rhythm, they go and they come back, go and come back, and that has to happen for iFile progress to happen.
Yeah.
They're not just walking in, gee, they take all this and go, wow, I'm well. It doesn't work like that. So if we get it in return, it's usually coming back for more help. It's usually coming back for another try, which we've gone, my gosh, we can go 10, 15, like, there's no number. People say, how many chances? Well, if you're willing to try and I'm willing to try, like for me, it would just be safety, really. I wouldn't look at anything else.
And that's part of our job. We have to keep trying with the
clients.
If I have to send someone to treatment 10 times, well, that's my job. And
they're learning opportunities.
Yeah, they are. Absolutely.
And that's what you got to do, is teach them how to, teach them how to, roll around.
If I may speak to this, please.
Actually, not at this point, unfortunately. We're running out of time.
May I just compliment these people, though? They don't know me. I know who they are. But I have had someone working for me for 18 months, impeccably behaved, who was under their care.
Yeah, they do good work, for sure. Councilor Stewart, Councilor Dival, and then we have to wrap it up.
Yeah, I just thank you. I just wanted to thank you, Paul and Roxanne, for the work that you do. I know that many people would not show up every day to do the work that you do. And the success of the program is really based on the relationships that you have with the clients out there. The success of the program would not be what it is without the dedication of yourself, Paul, and the owner, Anwar, who, as Paul said, has given that facility for no charge and maintains it.
Wow.
So it's truly, he needs to be acknowledged as well as a huge contributing factor in this community. He pays water, sewer, garbage, taxes, all of those things, and installs things that need to be installed, all at his own cost and nothing to us. That takes
but the tenants pay rent.
The tenants pay
rent.
Yeah,
so it's not a volunteer thing.
But certainly, thank you for what you do. Thank you for showing up.
Of course.
Thanks for inviting us.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Okay, a couple 3-minute break and then we'll head into the public hearing.